So what we are next going to see is it possible to, instead of focusing on all the context, can we do some restriction on this context, or like group this context, and then we can see whether we can get a better regret. So what could be the possibilities? So naturally we are seeing that if this context is very large, right, I mean just applying, maintaining a separate exp3 algorithm or one algorithm for each context is a very costly affair. Okay, so we have to think a bit more here. Okay, so for that let's look for some special, again like the way we did it in linear bandits, where we assume that my rewards, mean rewards are linear, right? So let's look at for some special cases where we will be able to bring down this dependency on the size of cardinality of my context set. Okay, so one possibility is so what learner is doing in all this setup is, given a context, he is trying to identify which is the best arm for it, right? So in the standard bandit setup, where we ignore totally contextual information, what we did, we always try to look for a single best arm, right? We always try to see which is the single best arm, and that was our benchmark. Against that benchmark we compared our algorithm. But now we are saying this, see, it is not always the case that there is always going to be a single best arm. The best arm is context dependent. We have discussed this, right, last time. So if you want to recommend a movies to the people who log into your recommendation system, it is not that there is a single best movie that everybody likes, right? It depends on who is that person is, and what is his profile, or when I say profile is things like his age, his past activities and all these things. So now what we are looking is, fine, for every context the best term could be different. Now instead, what we are now looking at, we are trying to do is, we are trying to learn a function in a way which gives, given context, what is the best term to play. Earlier we are just interested in one arm, finding one arm. Now for every context we want to find the best term. So the problem boils down to looking for a function which is, given my context, it want to tell me what is the arm to play. My search is basically over such functions, right? For every given context I want to basically identify which is the best action. So I could rewrite this regret in a form . And what is phi here? This phi is collection of all phi which maps C to K. So can I think of this regret more generally like this? I am now interested in finding a function which maps each context to a particular arm. So, what is this saying? If you are going to, okay, you take a function phi, if you are going to use that function phi, that means you are going to basically select the arm phi ct in round t. What is ct here? Ct is the context that appears in round t, and this is the total reward you would have got if you are going to use the function phi. And now what you are interested is, you are trying to get a best phi, that means the best reward you would have got over time period t, and that is your benchmark. And now you are going to compare that against what is the total reward you would have got yourself using a policy pi, your policy pi, right? Yeah, all functions. This one, yeah, because I want to see like, so my, what is basically learner is doing? Learner is basically mapping a context to an arm. We are now just looking what is the best you would have got. What is the best map that maximizes this regret, maximizes the reward. So, you are a learner, for every context I give, you have to decide which is the arm to play, and obviously you want to like to play, and you like to map it in such a way that the reward you are going to get over time period t, that is going to be maximized. Yeah.
If that minus capital X t was not inside the matrix, if it was outside, then that liquid and this liquid are the same, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So, in fact, this does not depend on this phi, right? You could as well write it as the both are the same, because this is just a generalized version of this. Here you are looking at, yeah, I mean right now I have, let us say this is all possible functions, okay, all possible maps, yes, in this case this should are identical.
Okay.
They may not be, but if I allow all possible phi, then I could, this is exactly saying what is phi of x here. Phi x, x is nothing but exactly argmax of this. So, in this case, suppose let us say, so in this case I could define phi of x to be argmax of this exact quantity. Of course, I have to have ct equals to 0. Every? You are allowing every possible maps, but in that you are looking for such a map which maximizes this, and I can always define such a map, right? So, this is provided you know already all these XTIs in every round, that is, this is the thing in hindsight, what you would have got in hindsight, okay? So, again here when I am doing this maximization, I am doing this maximization assuming that I know all the reward assignment that has happened in every round and to each of the arms, okay. And naturally as you see here, posing yourself. So, what is this? You are competing, this is what you would have got, and you are trying to compete yourself against a benchmark which is trying to get the best possible thing, and it is going to get the best possible thing by knowing all the information, and you are trying to compare yourself against this by knowing none of this information, right? So, you are doing, I mean in the sense that you are only learning it and trying to do. But this guy is trying to get this value by knowing all the values, right? So this is the oracle here. The oracle here is knowing all the values that has been assigned in each to each arms in each round, and then it is trying to see what is the best you could have got. Now you competing against such an oracle is maybe very, you are asking for too much, right? Like because this guy, the benchmark you are setting is such that it knew all the information. If you want to get a similar performance like this case here, you could guess guarantee is this, and this regret bound is reasonable if this phi is small, sorry, this cardinality of c is small. If this is small, this is large, then you may not be able to guarantee a good regret performance. So for that, what we will do is we are going to weaken this benchmark. Okay, so this is always the case, like when you are going to do such kind of performance, right? There are two things here. What is the benchmark you are going to set? If you are going to set yourself a weak benchmark, yes, your actual algorithm may come as close to that benchmark, and in that case your regret may be zero, but the actual reward you got may be poor. Okay, but you may try to set a very very high benchmark, like as we have done here. This is what the oracle would have got, and you are trying to try to get something as close as oracle, so you are making your life very difficult, right? It is very difficult to achieve that. So it is always important, like whenever you are going to set up such a things, what is the benchmark you want to compare against? You should not set your benchmark either to be too easy so that it is much easier for you, or you don't want to set it too difficult so that you are never going to achieve. So for example, in our class, we don't want everybody to score simple question and everybody score 100. And actually, it would have happened that none of you knew anything, but you still got 100 because the questions were too simple. Or otherwise, like we just set two hard questions so that none of you got high scores. I just made your life difficult, right? Maybe you have learned, but it's just that you couldn't score too well because the benchmark was too difficult. So what is that benchmark we are going to set? So for that, now we are going to see a few possibilities, and then we focus on a particular benchmark. A couple of things we are going to do is, these are some potential things we are going to talk about. Partitions. So in this, we are going to assume that yes, we have many possible contexts, but some contexts are very identical. That means if you know something on a particular context, you kind of already know the same thing happens on another context, which you believe is going to be the same as this context. Okay, so let's try to formalize that. So P be partition of C. So understand what I mean by partition, right? So let's take P to be a partition of C, and then we are going to look for this phi where and then I am going to further enforce a constraint that phi of C1 is equals to phi of C2 if C1 and C2 belongs to same set in P. You understand this? So what we are doing is, let's say this is my context set. I just assuming take one partition, let's say this is one partition. If let's say if this there are two contexts from this, they will have the same value. Everybody in this region we are going to have the same value. That means if I know something about one context in this region, I already know everything about the other context in that region. So in this case, do I need to maintain one exp3 algorithm for each context? So then I need to maintain one exp3 for each partition. Okay, so I can just maintain one for each of this, and in that case, how does this bound is going to change? So it is going to be simply the number of elements in the partition, right? So in that case, if I am going to if I am going to restrict myself to such a phi, then if I am going to use sp3, this is going to guarantee that 2 times, instead of this I am going to write it a cardinality of P times tk log k. So do not confuse, okay, not this one, yeah. So how to write this? So P is a set of sets, right? It is a partition. Cardinality of P, so I hope, so if I write, will not get confused, right? Like, so it is the number of sets in this set, okay, so that is fine. So and depending on how big, how many elements are there in this partition, accordingly you are going to get the regret bound, okay. So for example, if you are going to make it like a single partition, this guy is going to be 1. If you have 2 sets in this, this guy is going to be 2, okay. So it often happens that, yeah, yes. No, but we are just saying if we have the prior information that the set, so we are basically weakening the benchmark, right? So we are weakening, we are saying that we are looking for such a phis where such a thing already is happening. So when I am going to here there is no constraint on phi, so this is like the hardest benchmark I could get. But when I put such a constraint on this phi, it is like a less competitive benchmark for me, okay. So can you think of other possibilities? What kind of other, how can I further weaken my benchmark? And I want to weaken my basically benchmark, and I don't want to be like a too simple one. Like I don't want like very very tough benchmark which hard to crack, and a trivial one which anybody will crack. So what could be other possible good benchmarks? Okay, so in all this recommendation system, the way so you might have all this seen this movie recommendation systems, right? How do they recommend you? Even though you might have logged in into the recommendation system for the first time, they will still able to show something to you. how they would have done it. Yeah, so they might have seen that, okay, so your age is XYZ, you come from this geographical area and you have done this, that is your profile. But before you are not the only one who is going to entering their system, right? Many people have also logged into there to see, watch movies or download movies. Other people who have done it, they might have already rated them, because every time you watch something, they will ask you to rate, right? Okay, so that guy, whatever he has liked, that may provide some information about what you like. Is there a possible, how can this system can derive this information? Right, so some similarity score can be defined between the context, right? Like suppose if this is the feature and this guy has this given these rankings to this, now this guy's his feature. I am going to compare this guy's feature with all the possible feature vectors I have, that is profiles, and I see that where this guy's feature matches closely with already the things I have in my database. If it matches, maybe I will feel that, okay, this profile looks very similar to this profile, and maybe this guy will also like the similar things that the guy already with the similar profile liked, and then that may show you. So in that way, we can come up with a similarity score here, and based on that, try to further restrict my phi function here. Okay, so based on similarity function. So for this, obviously we need to define a similarity function. We are going to define it as simply so let's say there is some function I already come up with. Given two context, it will say give a number between 0 and 1. So this similarity score could be 1 if the two profiles match very much, and it is 0 if they are not matching. Okay. So in this case, you can think of only those phi functions for which the average similarity score is, or average dissimilarity score is, less than some threshold. Okay, so let me formalize this. So what is the average? So let's say I want to now define for a given phi function what is the average dissimilarity score. Okay, so given phi, I'm going to define average dissimilarity as 1 upon So can you all read this? So what it is doing is, so it is going to take a pair of context, and on those points which your function C do not agree, it is going to compute what is the dissimilarity score on those two, and it is going to sum it over all possible pairs and normalize. So if my phi is agreeing on some CD, I don't need to worry about that. I will worry about all the points where my phi function does not agree, and now I will see that how much is the dissimilarity. So I have defined S as the similarity one, so 1 minus S is the dissimilarity score here. Okay, and now yeah. Cardinality of I am not worried about partition here, right? Like I am taking all of them. So this is for the previous part. Now I am just defining my similarity function over all pairs, and now I am only looking for the dissimilarity scores where they don't. It could be, right? Like you just take a phi that is given to you. So there are so many phis, right? So many assignments can be possible. You take a phi, and if on some pair it is, and it's not necessary that if it is true for every, and it may possible that take any two pairs, the phi could be assigning different values, or it could be possible that some pairs it could be assigning the same value. It is just worrying about the cases where that phi is not assigning the same value to that pair, and now taking the dissimilarity score over all possibilities. Now you want to make sure that this dissimilarity score is not too high. Yes, phi and yes, definitely. It is defined. So this is defined for a you take phi. And S is already you have chosen, that is whatever favorite you have, you took it, and for that you are going to define. You pick it, okay. Yeah, it is up to you. Fine, but that is not the only phi you want to learn over, right? Okay, so what I want to do is the way I set my phi here like that. So let me call this quantity as another thing. So dissimilarity score, dissimilarity of phi. Okay, and also let me write it as S, because this depends on this function S also. Okay, so now what I will do is here I am going to look for all phi such that my d s of phi is less than some theta. So I am now basically not looking considering to optimize this function over all phi, but only those phis where the dissimilarity is not too much. So we are not trying to reduce this, right? We have defined it in this way and only looking for those phis who do not have too much of dissimilarity. So this is, as I said, if you just let this theta to be like arbitrarily large, that means it will incorporate all possible phis and it will be like same as this phi. But now as I am telling you, I want to like weaken this benchmark. And I want to say that it is only going to look to optimize over those phis which will try to group this context based on that similarity scores. It is like, so you are going, this is up to you, right? Like say you are going to either search over all possible phis, or you can search over only those phis where the dissimilarity is not too high. Okay, so other way of thinking it is like say like in the recommendation system we are going to have, right? You can, your algorithm, the recommendation system basically when it is going to search and give the recommendations for you, right, it will have certain set of policies like this, okay. Now if you have to find the best one or all this, it may be too much big task for it. So that is why I am going to restrict only those fees, assuming that this already captures a big chunk of all fees. So there won't be, so whatever the profiles I am going to create among the users, right, for every user, I am assuming that the profiles of users like won't vary drastically. Okay, fine, let us take some people are visiting a recommendation system, right. So when I am going to design this theta, I am going to assume that at least they will have something in common. Because of that, their dissimilarity will not be too much. And that is why I am going to restrict my search space to smaller fee. Okay. And if I further know that all these guys are coming from IIT Bombay, I will still set this theta to be smaller, because all these guys are young guys who is going to have a similar interest, right. So this is based on my prior information. And if I know that, so all this, like suppose if it is a sports site, it already knows that like most of the guys who are coming to it are like young guys. So some of the features are going to be common there, right. So then they will have already some similarities. Based on that you can restrict, okay, fine. So this is just another possibility, right. And indeed these are actually used, like depending on your prior information, what kind of customers you are going to get, you are going to, because you do not want to arbitrarily search over a big space here, okay. The other possibility is, what could be the other possibility? Yeah. Other possibility is as simple as this, like theek hai kitna bhi ho isme, like how many are there in this, I do not care about them, but I am going to only restrict myself to few of them. So you are going to further have some kind of a priori information. All this mappings are not possible, only few mappings are possible. You are going to initially shortlist them, but you do not know among them which is the best, you want to still figure out, but at least initially itself you will narrow down your search, and by restricting yourself to certain number of fee functions. Should that be fine, or that is a very bad thing to do? So I am just going to take this fee to be just a collection of fee 1, some fee 2, all the way up to let us say fee m. Some m set of functions, and I want to just find which one is best among them, right. I mean this is most of the case, right, like you do not want to deal with yeah, this is always the case, we will not always have infinitely many options, right. We have few options, and from that we have to pick the best one. And in that sense we can think of the number of possible mappings are finite, which you would have narrowed down, like which you are going to select among fee, I do not know, that comes from your expertise for that particular application. Like for example in the recommendation system, you may be already knowing that if you go to some e-commerce site, and if you already know, if you are a young guy, I already know that it is unlikely that you are going to look for some insurance policy, right. So that mapping, that given a young guy looking for an insurance policy, that option I already rule out. And that will already eliminate certain number of policies. So based on that, I will rule out certain policies and narrow down to certain number of policies, and then I am going to search which one the best among them. Okay. So now, okay, fine, I have narrowed down. Is it any simpler? Can you think of what is a good way to search on this? But it is not still necessary that these two functions should assign the same value to any particular context. It is not necessary, right? They could be all be assigning different.
From the original set, we have narrowed it down. So
yeah. How we did, right now we are not telling you. I am just saying somebody did it for you. We will always have some sales team, some big PR teams and all these things, right? Like they will narrow down, well, they will already like they will say, rule out, okay, so this is not making sense, rule it out. Then what is possible, then you are going to narrow down, and from that available options, then you are going to optimize what is the best you could do. On that, we are not going to make any assumption. Is it? So what is this phi function? Phi function is still doing with dealing with different contexts, right? Phi is again has to see which for which context, which arm you are going to select. Okay. So now, so then what is a good policy here? So one possibility is like each is like a bandit problem in its own right. Like if you just take a policy phi, okay, so what is this phi is basically you want to identify the best term, okay. Okay, okay, so let's go back to, so do you recall our weighted majority setting? What did we do there? Yeah, so what would we say set that setup as? What we said that setup as? Yeah, we said that as prediction with expert advice, right? So prediction with expert advice, what we said there, the expert is going to, so there expert is going to tell us which arm to play, and what we did there, we go basically assigned a weight to each of the expert. And based on that, we are going to pick an expert and we are going to observe the loss or reward accordingly. Now, can we think of this phi functions as different experts and I want to identify the best one? But what is the difference here? Yeah, I mean, okay, fine, let us think fully information, okay, let us compare EXP3 only. EXP3 we had only bandit information, right? We only observed the expert we played there. Then is that just simple EXP3 here? So in EXP3 what we did, we actually maintained a distribution over the arms, right? In EXP3 we actually maintained a distribution on arms based on the cumulative loss or reward we have observed so far, and then try to play the one which has like according to some distribution which we updated in every round. So now is it worthwhile to maintain the distribution over these experts? How do you update? We'll come to that later. That's an algorithm. But in terms of the broad structure of the policy, if I want to just, okay, now we have this narrowed down to this. Now I want you to just think about an algorithm, at least the broad steps. So is it like, okay, like if we can now think these as different experts on which I want to maintain. So what these guys can do? Each guy is going to basically tell, this is a mapping, right? For each context, what should be the arm? This guy is going to tell, okay, you use this arm. Now I want to, whatever that guy tells me to do in each round, based on that I can maintain a distribution over him. And if I pick this particular expert, then whatever that guy tells me to play in that round, I will play that, and I observe the reward, and based on that, if I get a good thing or bad thing, I am going to update my weight on that expert, and I will continue this. Okay, so based on this idea, we are going to see an algorithm called EXP4 next time. You have seen EXP3, right? So what is EXP4? So what is EXP3? Exploration and exploitation with exponentially weighted. So now exploration. So what was exactly EXP3? What was first EX? What is the first? Say that again. Exponentially weighted algorithm exploration and exploitation for experts. So this is the EXP4 algorithm, which we'll study in the next class. For each guy, you want to do A/B testing. What is that? What did you get if you do A/B testing on each? Yeah, by A/B, how we are applying A/B on each fee one here? Yeah. Yeah. We will do a version of that A/B testing only, right? What EXP3 and we are all doing there. We are just playing them and getting information about how they are doing, and then we are updating about the weights. Just like we have more experts here and we want to identify an expert. Okay, so let's continue in next class.